So here's the project instead of these two huge, huge. And they are of course connected back to back. So this is my old isolation transformator for my different projects. And there is of course a huge amount of capacity in these. So I ordered some toroids. Yay! 300 VA each. Those are actually nice and heavy. All right, before I do anything, I will measure what they do and how much of this and that. So look at this, the secondary windings, they're specified 2 × 12 volts, 12.5 amps. Let's measure the DC resistance in one secondary winding, only 38 milliohms. And the primary winding is 4 ohms. Now we got power on it, and the idle use is 1.7 watts for only one of them. All right, let's try and measure the capacity between the primary and secondary windings. Of course, I've taken all the secondary windings and coupled them together. And of course, again, the primary windings, and then we measure the capacity. We've got different means of measuring the capacity. One way is just to use the feature in a multimeter. Oh, we can also try a little bit more nice way to measure it with a 4-point measurement, and we'll get about 500 picofarad. And the reason you're right here is that you can go frequencies up and frequencies down, and in this broad range of test frequencies, you're going to get the same result. So that is a little bit, how this instrument works. All right, so 500 picofarads. Okay. So that is 60 watts of load. 225 output. That is actually really, really impressive. Two of these are now back-to-back connected. And the input is 229 and 58 watts. So that is a little bit interesting. The two transformators from primary to secondary side, because they are now coupled together, because I want to make an isolation transformator. So we just realized that we have had like 500 picofarads in one. So 500 in series with another 500. So we should measure about 250 is my best guess, right? But we got 240, and that is just fantastic. So 240 picofarad from one to the other one. What if I put them, let's try and put them on top of each other and see if I put them real close like this. 241 or something like that. Now they are on top of each other, and now I put them side by side. Now let's stand them up on the sides like this and see if that is, that's weird. Anyway, we are very close to the 250, which is of course half of each of them. So original diameter is about 113 millimeters. And including everything, so originally, this is grams. All right, let's take this to pieces. Are we having fun yet? I don't think we need to video this, because this is going to take a long time. Phew, this is really, really difficult. I think I underestimated the work to be done here. It took like 5 minutes just to get that long. Are you kidding me? It's also because they are using a lot of tape and all that. And also I'm very, very careful not to destroy the secondary windings, because those are really, really nice and thick. Of course I'm going to reuse them. So that is why I am careful not to destroy them. So I want to get the secondary windings off in one good go. At least that is the goal, until I find out that that is not possible. But it should be possible, right? Just to take these out. How thick is this massive, massive copper here? It is just amazingly thick. Oh. It's wound two and two. So of course both of the secondary windings will have exactly the same coupling and the same voltage and the same DC resistance. So you can parallel them and series them and you get exactly the same. So this is how they're all done. So when you're taking this off and you're half the way, then it is a good opportunity to start from the other end. Now this length is about 2 meters, so it's getting a little bit annoying to get all this through here. But whew. So that was half of it. Yeah. You gotta see this. 20 grams. This is the primary alone. And now it is 108 millimeter diameter. Whoa. So that is quite a lot of copper on the secondary side. Are you kidding me? So this is just a very fast introduction to the 3D design that I made for this project. So the idea is I put the two toroids in here and then simply just screw everything together with self-tapping screws into a handle. I made it so that each of the five main parts, they're quite small, so I can print them on all my printers at the same time, and this way be done really, really fast. This is the front panel with the outlet, and the rear, the power entry, on-off switch, fuse. Yeah, it's a really, really simple design. And this will be the hole for the wire to come out of the transformator. I made the self-tapping screws or holes for the self-tapping. Everything is made so it can be printed without any kind of support. Of course, this is the flat side down to the bed, and so on. Anything can be done without support. Of course, this is how we do it. This side, you just print this side down, and the rear panel, this side down. So this is just to make it a little bit stronger. You will be accessing the on-off switch. You don't want this to be flimsy. So, all right, let's go 3D print this. So here's the reason why I made the design in five different main pieces. Now it can be printed on smaller printers running in parallel. And this way, you will be done five times as fast, doing all of them at the same time. All parts are now printed. I've sanded a little bit and I smoothen a little bit here with a blade, just so that I'm not going to cut the wires too much. The handle, everything turned out pretty good. I removed a little bit of elephant foot so that all the parts will line up straight and nice. So now I'm going to see how everything works. So the first test is to see. Yep. See? And this is all the isolation distance that I got. So this is quite a lot. Actually, it's a lot. Because there is a limiting problem here. The smaller I make the center, that means this will limit the amount of copper wire that I can put through. And this is maybe a little bit overdoing it. All right. First try. We got this primary running at 231 volts. Of course, we got the same output because it's unloaded right now. What you see here is only 1/4 of the copper that we need. So it's only one of the four secondary windings I've been able to put through so far. But it took quite a while and it is a lot of messy because it's really curly around here and it's annoying. But I will find a way to fix this. So let's try and see what happens with this very, very little copper. Way too little, of course. Let's turn on the load. And now you see, voltage drop to 211. Ooh, it's hot. All right, so that was the first try. We need more copper. No surprises yet. I am so sorry for this messy video, but after the failure with the secondary windings and reusing the secondary windings, I must admit that the resistance in this copper is just way too high, and the copper density that you can make when you're reusing copper like this, that is just too curly and messy, is going to be too little, because what you need is to fill up the entire space here, otherwise the resistance will be way too high. So now I have a new theory, and I will see if I can make something with a lot less resistance. Here's what we did. Wind a lot of copper on a chair, and the reel was hanging on another chair like this. What a job! And look at that. This is pure copper, huh? 0.7 millimeter each. And a whole lot of it. Now it's cut to two pieces like this, and I think it will fit just fine. So we are through the hole. I could actually have made it a little bit thicker, but I was getting really, really tired. So now I just have to bend this and this together and connect all these together, and we will be ready for the first try. Maybe this is going to be the never-ending story of things to do. But I think this is going to help, pressing everything really, really hard together. So I will get a really, really good connection. Obviously, I knew that plastic is not going to work. There's cable ties, they don't have enough force to create a very good and stable connection. But this should work. So this is going to be the final test before assembly. I think I cannot do it any better with this method, because it is all filled up with copper wires. Of course, you can make it with a solid copper bar. That will be the way to win over this solution, because obviously there is a lot of air in this, and also the joint or the connection between the windings here, that is absolutely the weakest point. This is adding a lot of resistance, and imagine this is 30 millimeter in diameter, this the copper in the assembly joint, but still there's a lot of resistance in this joint. This is really, really crazy. But we're also talking about 1500 amps. So it is quite a lot of amps, and the current needs to be, or the resistance needs to be really, really low for this to work. All right, let's get back to the load of the output. Damn it, this is impossible. Come on, damn it. 218, and that is only 60 watts. So, of course, it's dropping a little bit. But this is as good as I can do it with this solution because of the length. So before the very last assembly, let's measure the capacity from the primary to the secondary side of this monster insane thing. What the heck have I done? But alright, 7 picofarad. I am very, very happy about that result. So this is the last of the assembly. This is the output connector. Don't you just love 3D printed designs and self-tapping screws? This is just super, super easy, and everything just fits. So easy it is. So now I am completely done with this isolation transformator for mains. It was a lot of work and a lot of pain to build this, but I'm really happy the way it turned out to be. It is really, really heavy, so I'm happy that I made a really good and stable handle for it. I planned for some extra screws in the bottom here and some rubber feet or something, so maybe I will install them one day. It really looks crazy. All right. Yeah, I think this is the end of this video. I have created the lowest capacity isolation transformator that I have ever built, and it is now ready for testing and use and experiments. Fantastic.